Now, in a write-up to the Daily Monitor, Dr. Kizza Besigye, who's the former FDC party president, claims that President Museveni knows the UPDF has no capacity nor the competence to manage agricultural projects given its track record. That is his comments on the president's move to have the military move into NADS and take over the operations of NADS. And that was titled Museveni Wrong to Militarize NADS. Dr. Besigye says that's our discussion tonight on Newsnight. So finally, Dr. Besigye weighs in his thoughts on the president's move to have the military involved in NADS activities. Andrew, very many thanks for joining us on Newsnight, the old man of the clan and CEO of the Independent magazine. Very quickly, it is not shocking for Besigye to critique the president and write in the press once in a while when the president has made a certain move. But he does, in his letter or his notes here to the Monitor, mention a few issues he has with the latest move to have the army involved in agricultural services. And his most important concern is the fact that the UPDF has no knowledge and competence to actually run the activities in the agriculture sector, especially NADS.
Well, first of all, let me assume the UPDF had the competences to run activities in the agriculture sector. The president would be making a fundamental error. One of the reasons you can criticize President Yoweri Museveni about is whenever an institution of government fails to work, rather than seek to reform it so that it can perform its functions, he creates a parallel institution. In this case, you transfer responsibilities of agriculture to an institution whose job it is to defend this country. So you, first of all, therefore, it's a wrong proposal, not because the army does not have the competencies to run NADS, but it is, there are two levels of the argument. A, the president is wrong on NADS. He thinks that NADS was supposed to distribute fertilizers, improved seed and farm implements. NADS, as its name suggests, is a National Agricultural Advisory Services.
But what changed? Because that was what was it was set up to do.
It was supposed to
offer advisory services, but it turned out to do something else.
Because the president and the NRM get votes, and farmers understand that the NRM is supporting and helping them when they're given farm implements, when they're given improved seed, when they're given fertilizers, when they're given credit, when they're given pigs and chicken and goats. So the president turned NADS not statutory, but in actual practice, and started pushing them to deliver these things. But they were not institutionally set up to deliver those things, and two, they do not have the technical competences to do so. So first, therefore, he is wrong to expect NADS to do what it was not set to do. But two, it would be wrong to assign roles of a civil institution to a military institution. And I would disagree with this on one thing. First, I think that if Besigye made this argument in 2004-2005, me and him would have been in the same position. The UPDF was corrupt, incompetent, and could not perform even the basic
functions. But things have changed 10 years down the road.
10 years down the road, the army has been reformed.
And you've said it here.
Yes, the UPDF is less corrupt now.
Yes.
It is much more efficient and competent in what it does. And in many countries, if you look at South Korea, if you look at Taiwan, if you look at Rwanda, the army has been a key player in leading areas of innovation. Even in America, you see this internet
True.
We have
yes.
started as an institution within the army. When the Cold War ended, the American government allowed it to be used by the private sector. Now, internet is the biggest business in the whole world. Why? But it was innovated by the army. So we should not say that the army cannot innovate and lead civic institutions in something.
The jury is still out there on levels of corruption in the army. We know a couple of officers are still in court on charges of corruption and sniffing our fuel in Somalia. We have the issues of Bantariza from Chankwanzi. Let's look at some of the concerns under the NADS project. We recently, last week actually, spoke to the head of NADS. And he had concerns. He said, in principle, like you've just said, this was a fantastic project, but it was based on seven other pillars. It was part of the seven pillars on the plan for modernization of agriculture, PMA.
Yes.
And he says those pillars, and I can quickly mention, research and technology development, agriculture, education, access to rural finance, agro-processing and marketing, natural resource utilization and physical infrastructure never set off.
Exactly.
The reason NADS failed.
Yes, that's the reason. Well, you could say that NADS has, you could not say really it has failed. The president said they had spent a lot of money on workshops and seminars. If you are an advisory if you are an advisory service, Morrison,
yes.
What do you do?
You meet.
Organize workshops,
yes.
And seminars,
share
and
ideas.
Educate farmers.
Yes.
And the president was saying they were doing the wrong thing. So I think that the Ministry of Agriculture and the PPL government did not advise the president correctly that this institution was, its basic function was to hold seminars and workshops. Its basic function was not to distribute improved seed and pigs to farmers.
Basically raises a concern here. And he says that actually NADS was being run under State House rather than in the Ministry of Agriculture.
That's not true.
And that he had an advisor in the president's office, Reverend Sister Mary Akirol, who was appointed as senior presidential advisor on NADS affairs. And that, yes, he says, was a weakness that failed the system.
It is not that it was being run from president's office. That is certainly false. But what I can say is that the president was always involved in NADS, trying to push them to do things that should have been done by another institution, or NADS should have been reformed to implement those things. By the way, I should tell you, yesterday, he wrote an article in the Weekly Observer, which is a long... He raises fundamental issues of the fusion of the state and the political party. You see, NRM and the government of Uganda are not separate. If you look at UPDF, it is formerly an armed, it is formerly NRA, which was an armed wing of the NRM. If you look at the other institutions of state, many NRM cadres, RDCs, Besigye raised a lot of important issues. The Monta article is perhaps a small part of a much wider argument he was making. And I asked myself, Besigye went to the bush with Museveni in an armed struggle. If you look at all armed struggle governments, governments that come to power after an armed struggle, whether in Mozambique, Angola, Rwanda, Ethiopia, Eritrea, Cuba, Vietnam, China, the fusion of state and party is an inevitable outcome of governments that dismantle the state from below through armed struggle and come and establish themselves. And therefore, I think that Besigye needs to have a certain modesty to say, I contributed to creating a situation whereby a democratic change of government in Uganda is almost impossible, because the nature of the struggle we led does not tend to create democratic transitions of power.
Finally, as we conclude, he says the UPDF as an institution has a very poor record regarding its participation in productive activities. It has squandered hundreds of millions of dollars in failed projects and major and more irrelevantly all its agricultural projects failed. Now, he says in 1989, the Ministry of Defense set up a state corporation, of course, you know, as NEC, to help UPDF officers and men participate in production. That failed horribly.
Yes, I wrote about it in my column last week, saying that all NEC companies were badly mismanaged, cannibalized by army officers, and finally were liquidated. And also, the assets were liquidated.
Things have changed in the UPDF.
But since then, things have changed. Really,
does this fall under the UPDF, or this really falls even under the president's brother, Salim Saleh, who of
NEC.
Course heads.
No, he did not.
Who heads the veterans? I'm saying the entire project now that is being handed the NADS project.
It is. Yeah. I think that to give NADS to the Ministry of Defense is going to be a big, big, big mistake. And the president should not do it. If you meet the president, Morris, please advise him that it's a wrong thing to hand over agricultural advisory services to soldiers. Soldiers cannot easily relate to civilians. First of all, they will want to issue commands and be obeyed. Civilians are very disciplined. Civilians, when you say stand, they say why. Soldiers say stand, they're up.
Let's quickly look at let's flip the coin and move to Rwanda. That has tried something. You know, there's the one cow, one house, you know, the cow per house.
Yes.
And
it's not run by the army.
Yes.
It's run by the Ministry of Agriculture.
Yes.
But the army has participated in terms of the army and the police and the security services have contributed cows to the Ministry of Agriculture, which delivers this. But I should tell you, the army in Rwanda.
Because I wanted to link the two, because you have that the army and the police actually still participating in agricultural services in Rwanda.
In Rwanda, the army directly has a direct involvement with farmers, where, because the army tries to teach farmers, extends agricultural credits to them, the army extends advisory services to farmers, the army is involved in giving them seed to plant. So the army is directly involved in productive activities. The army itself in Rwanda owns farms, agricultural farms, and the civilians are outgrowers supplying military installations. So there is a much more developed civil-military relations in Rwanda than it has been in Uganda. But I think because UPDF these days has pushed up its internal competences, I think that Aronda, when he was there as army commander, Aronda really needs credit. He did a good job in reforming the army and moving it from a predatory institution to a much more professional institution. The worst thing to happen to the army, of course, immediately professionalized, if you begin giving it many duties, running banks, running agriculture, running this and this, you will dilute its professional competence. I think that its professionalism should be used sparingly. It should not be, you may find that the army is overdeveloped in function, yet it is underdeveloped in capacity. So its reach is beyond its grasp. That will be a very big danger.
That's a very nice topic we will probably discuss soon. The fact that they have the biggest SACCO now as the army, and that
in Rwanda the army has become a bank.
Yeah, and I see their SACCO turning into a bank. But that's a discussion for another day when we look at how we can actually run the army on their own finances without actually dipping their hand in the national cake.
Do you know that in Indonesia,
yes,
85% of the government budget in Indonesia is from profits by army parastatals. Now, in Egypt, you saw the other day, the government ran broke and the army lent government money.
So that's the discussion we'll probably have, and we'll need examples to look at that. Well, that was Newsnight.